Thanks, Polly. We receive hundreds of comments a month from one online community in particular, and that is around Biafra. Now, the Indigenous People of Biafra, or IPOB, is an organization that's calling for secession in southeastern Nigeria. They have a hope for an independent state for the Igbo people, who make up about 18% of Nigeria's population of 190 million plus. Now, pro-Biafran Igbo have long complained of discrimination by the Nigerian establishment, which is dominated by two other larger tribes, the Hausa Fulani and the Yoruba. So there's lots of history here. I don't have enough time to get into all of it, but there's also different versions of it. 50 years after Nigeria's civil war was fought over this very issue. Our colleagues over at The Stream tackled it a few months back on the 50th anniversary of that war, so do check it out for more on the history and the movement. Now, last month, IPOB was declared a terrorist organization by the Nigerian military. Civil society groups say this move could encourage the organization to ditch its policy of nonviolence. And their leader, Nnamdi Kanu, was due in court in Abuja on Tuesday to face treason charges. Problem is, no one seems to know where he is. He hasn't been seen in public since September 14th, when his home was attacked. And at the time, the government spokesman suggested Nanu had fled the country. Nigerian troops said they were in Abia State to stop what they call secessionist agitations, but they denied any raid had taken place. But Kanu's supporters think they heard an admission of guilt from the defense minister this past weekend, and many have been sharing this clip online.
His lawyer or his other people should come up and tell us, as far as we are concerned, we didn't go for Kanu, and that is why I told you the issue of Python dance has nothing to do with IPOP. They went there for their normal constitutional duty of training. That is it. We are the one that went for him, and we didn't. He was not seen then, you know, but he went into hiding. So we are also looking for him.
So for weeks now, Kanu's lawyer has accused the government of holding him and members of his family in secret. But now he says he doesn't know if his client is dead or alive. IPOP supporters told the federal government to produce him in court on Tuesday or face consequences, but he did not appear. Now, Kanu's trial has been adjourned until November 20th, and both sides have accused each other of not producing him on courts or in courts during that appearance on Tuesday. So we'll continue to monitor that situation. If you're in Nigeria, do let us know what you think. You can tweet me directly. I'm at Andrew Chappelle, or just use the hashtag AJNewsGrid.
Andrew, thank you very much. And still ahead on the grid, if you're watching us on Facebook.
Oh, man. Yakubu Dogara, and my very distinguished colleagues. You will recall in the 7th Assembly that I proposed a bill for the Federal University of Petroleum, EFRU. The bill was adequately debated and passed by the House, but wasn't signed into law by the former president. You will also recall that that same bill was represented in this 8th Assembly by my humble self. It was duly debated, adequately passed by this House, and sent to the Senate for concurrence. I stand here today to thank you that the President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria has signed that bill into law. Signing that bill into law is being appreciated by the people of Delta State. The Urhobo people are appreciating this House for giving us the opportunity to have the footprint bill signed into, passed and signed into law. Signing that footprint bill into law is of great importance to the people of Urhobo Nation, to the people of Delta State and Niger Delta in general. Our youths who graduated from the university and the ones who are still there now have their confidence restored, that their certificates will no longer be a certificate of mockery, but a certificate that they can present nationally and internationally. The signing of that bill into law has further given our streets, that our youths who are on the streets, the confidence to go back to school. That bill will take a lot of youths out of the streets, and that bill will further increase the economy of the immediate community, the host community and environment, because a lot of business will take place around the university. the children of the people of the host community will also have the opportunity to attend the university. So I want to use this opportunity to thank Mr. Speaker and thank my honorable colleagues and members of the secretariat, the clerks who are also working under the clerk of the House of Reps. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, for the privilege. God bless you.
Honorable colleagues,
you can remain standing across our borders. We don't want to be taken unaware. We are a country that is well prepared. We need to make adequate arrangements with safety of refugees and also to ensure that these refugees don't affect our national security.
The team then moves to the government house to bring the state governor up to date on the expected influx of refugees into the state.
She estimated that around 40,000 Cameroonians might migrate as refugees into Nigeria. And when we did the analysis, cross-river is going to be the most affected because of the movement. We noticed already around 300 people have registered. That's why I came to cross-river, to work with him, to make sure we respect human rights. Also, we don't allow migrants to spoil our security situation, but we also respect them with dignity. The Cameroonian government has done the same for us in terms of the Boko Haram crisis.
If Africa never raised the existence of our foreign policy, Nigeria must be interested in not just the protection of Nigerians within the borders of Nigeria, but what happens in Africa. I think we have a very big responsibility. You must come back to Mr. President and see that he realizes, or perhaps you need to have a very strong private session with him. Your budget has to be expanded. Crossroads is ready to support you with your budget.
Effective manning of the country's borders has become more necessary in recent times, especially at the peak of insurgency in the country that had put relevant government agencies on their toes. This time, however, Nigeria is preparing to receive refugees from Cameroon in a clear demonstration to uphold the agreement between member countries of the Lake Chad to collaborate on areas of security within the region.
One news track returns. Nigerians are anxiously waiting for the comprehensive rehabilitation plan of the Tin Can.